us today. Would you please welcome to the stage Dr. Jolie Turnbull. Only help.
your body doesn't need it, well, you're living right, and thank God, here for that. So some of the systems that has already been talked about with the endocannabinoid deficiency syndrome that we see in humans, just wanted to kind of take another look at all that. Fibromyalgia, irritable bowel syndrome, we've got post-traumatic stress syndrome, anxiety and depression, lupus, and just a thousand times more. So look at that picture, that slide. Holding his head down, well, it might be pressing into the wall, or it's squinting in the light. Manny, does that sound familiar? I mean, did you want to press your head into the wall with these migraines? I mean, they have everything we have. If you're just quiet, it probably goes back to the mindfulness that Dr. Vasilva was talking about. If you're quiet and you watch how your animal behaves and interacts, you're going to glean so much. They are speaking volumes to you. And so that's one of the biggest reasons, I think, that I have gotten into this company, Zelis, aside from the ultrasound aspect of it all. I've mentioned this to Dr. Andrea. I've been, you know, just like Dr. Andrea in my profession for over 20 years, and I've attended, you know, national veterinary conferences. There's 8,000 people in. I've never felt the energy that I feel in this room with Zelis people of mindset, you know. It makes me want to just bring out the Kentucky redneck and go, there, you are pub med search. It is all over. Do your own research. Open your mind. Expand your knowledge. Stop taking the spoon-fed knowledge that Big Pharma is giving us that this is what we have to do. Look at ways that we can help ourselves with natural products. We're in the same dilemma that the human doctors are in. When you give a medication for X, Y, and Z, well, you got to give another medication for the side effects for that medication. Mm-hmm. So I have probably decreased my amount of anti-anxiety medications in my canine patients and feline patients probably about 40-50%, you know, reaching for this, the natural substance. Let the body help itself. All day long, like Dr. Andrew be able to play. So again, nerve pain. This is exactly, you're going to be quiet and watching this dog. Anyone ever had sciatica? This is what you feel like doing. This dog has sciatica. He's got pinched nerve. That is the only thing he's done in medicine, you'll see a link.
That's what I have.
His spinal nerve is affected. The cord is a weakness. They're going to drag that leg. But that, it doesn't take a brain scientist to figure that one out, but he hurts. On this view, we talk about movement disorders in our dogs. What about that, Dr. Andrew? That's, you know, movement disorder. That's tremors. So Parkinson's, familial tremors. Cerebellitis, you know, we get all of those issues. This one is a little disturbing for, you know, those, you know, I'm sorry that I'm kind of used to this, but this is a seizure. This is, you know, generalized motor seizures. The thing, you know, the blessing in all this is this dog is, you know, completely unaware. Thank God for that protective mechanism, but he doesn't know this is happening. But this is one of the worst things as an owner or a parent, that you can see your dog or your child. So what puts also ahead of the pack? All the same things we keep talking about. We're very repetitive here because the truth, you can't hide it. It's the truth. It's like written on the tablets. You know, we need to be Moses up on the hilltop. You know, it is a full spectrum hymn. Again, no way we're going to see the benefits that we are appreciating without it being that, without that entourage effect, that amplified effect of all those over 400 ingredients in this plant. It is, again, USDA certified organic, it's water soluble, we've got 25% more CBD in it, and the THC levels are 0.007%, so very, very minuscule. So we're not seeing the high, again, going back to the hemp seeds that we talked about, you know, our cereals and things. I am seeing an onset of action that's very similar to what we're seeing in human medicine. If I were to wait for clinical trials to come aboard and veterinary medicine, I'd be dead and gone. You know, we're gonna, I don't have time. I don't have that kind of time. I'm going to take the proof in the pudding. If I'm not hurting an animal and others are open to it, I want to see if it's going to benefit. And that's, again, why the hemp world came into play in my life. You know, I see way too much anxiety in the office setting, in the home setting. But for me, when they're coming into the front door, if I've got someone that's really willing to do this, and I see an animal starting to get kind of ramped up and very nervous by their environment, feeding off the owner, you know, it's a scary thing to come see someone like me. Your animal's got some serious problems if you're coming to see me. So I'll get permission to give them a dose. And I can tell you, just like Dr. Andrew said, within 5 minutes, 15 minutes, you see a quietness, a calmness come about the majority of them. And so does that not tug at your heart that you can give them a little bit of peace, make this be more like they're in their living room setting at home, and they're comfortable. That's what we want for these little creatures when you take them into our household. That's a picture of, that's upside down. Sorry about that. I don't know if you all can turn your heads upside down and watch that. But the interesting thing is the German Shepherd pointer in the background, if you can see that. He's running because I started him out. He's got just cognitive dysfunction syndrome. He's 14, so he's, you know, starting to not be quite normal. So I started him out on Barry first. Well, it's a dog, and my experience, Barry must taste like something awful. So my German Shepherd, I gave her the lemon, and she loves that. But Russell still thinks everything is Barry, and it's the devil's drink. Everyone wants to know the dosing suggestions, and you know, how did I come to this? Well, just continually, you know, searching the web, educating myself to the best that I can. Most of the hemp oil doses for dogs and cats are running about 2 mg/kg twice a day. So because of UltraShell's phenomenal absorption and bioavailability, I just chose to go 50% to 75% less. And it really seems to be working in the clinical setting and what my owners are telling me. So it really averages out to be about 1 to 2 drops rubbed on their gums or put over a tree twice a day for 20 pounds. That's drops, not drop a full, drops. So cats, you know, that would be about a half a drop on average. But I tell you what I'm also finding is that cats seem to tolerate higher doses than dogs. And I think it really goes back to the fact that I shared this with the little folks. I think cats are aliens, and they have confused on the species, and they think they're trying to take over the world. So, we've got a lot of this ordinance for inter-household fighting. Y'all was telling them about this inappropriate aggression that cats will display, where if an outdoor cat comes up on your windowsill, and you've got two, maybe three cats in the household, and one sees the one on the windowsill, starts to attack it, can't get to that one, so it turns around and beats up the brother. And from there on in, you have a problem. They don't forget it. They just decide that cat is really irritated. And so those kinds of things, they typically take a little higher dose. Very sweet woman who just followed me around the Kentucky area when I talked. She shows up at every meeting and tells me about a feral cat that she took in. She's up to 2 drops 3 times a day, and the cat will now sit on her lap, and if she misses a dose, it attacks her leg. I've been told I'm the fastest slow talker, so I'm running out of time here, but let me just get through this. You know, I don't know. I don't have any experience with horses and cats. It's out there. People are given it. There are products formulated for it. The dose that I'm seeing is about 60 milligrams for day-to-day overall health improvements, up to 200 milligrams for chronic muscle and joint and bone pain. So again, taking what I've done with dogs and cats, I'm assuming we can drop that back 50% to 75%. Any of you all that have been using ultrasound with horses, please reach out to me. You know, I want to know. I really want to educate myself on that end. I had a story. Someone approached me at one of these meetings about they've got a boar that they show, or they're into hogs shows, and an unruly bull boar, and they started giving him ultrasound prior to the show. Well, they've been winning, and everybody wants to know why they're winning now. And they're a little reluctant to tell them. This is a big problem in our pet birds. And I always say, the reason for this is a feather plucking event, it's not the prettiest thing you're going to see, but these animals are so far, are more intelligent than we give them credit for, especially these large birds. They're bored. You got to really, they have a lot of anxiety, a lot of pent-up stress. You can imagine them being in a cage all day long when they've got the mental equivalent of a six-year-old child. So imagine putting your six-year-old child in a cage where they can do this. You know, it's not going to work out well for you in about 5 to 6 years. So this is an anxiety-driven problem, I believe. We treat this in veterinarians with very high power drugs like Thorazine with minimal results. But I've got an associate, a friend of mine, who is a little bit of a bird boarder. He's a veterinarian here in Indiana. And I have supplied him with some to try on a couple of his versions of this, and he's getting feather growth back. I'm excited about that aspect of it. I'm going to kind of go through these little, wanted to get to this one in particular, just so you can see some of the OCD. Again, this came up upside down. Ryder is a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, who you all have. Cavaliers, thank you, because you're putting the veterinarian's shoulders to school. They have lots of issues. One of the things that they'll do, this is a manifestation of fly biting syndrome. And, I can probably put this dog on traditional anticonvulsants and maybe get some effect. I can probably put this dog on anti-anxieties and maybe get some effect. But let's make him a little quieter, easier between his ears. Let's have him have some faculties to realize life isn't that tough. So we started him on ultrasound, and he's not done this since then. Really, it took about 3 days for them to notice. And he was doing this about 20 to 40 times a day.
Oh, my God. Mm.
You. Omar is the little dog I think on your all's left, the little pit bull. He was one of those post-traumatic stress syndromes rescued from one of the hurricanes down south. Spent 3 years cowering in his household with his family members. He liked his family members who had adopted him, but everything else in the world terrified and scared him. And so he came to me for a facial palsy, which is the equivalent of Bell's palsy in humans. I wasn't that excited about it. It's going to get better. So the owners came to me for this problem. I'm going on and on about Bell's palsy in my mind, just going, this is not a big problem, it's just cosmetic, it'll be fine. Might have a joker's grin in about 8 weeks when those muscles contract, but otherwise the dog's going to be fine. He'll live his life out. But what struck me most was how terrified this dog was. He was behind the plant in our exam room. He was cowering, and his tail between his legs, which is, whenever a dog has a tail, the tail's between their legs, there's a problem mentally, emotionally, physically with that dog. So. I started talking about that to the owner about, I think there's some things we can do. And I looked up and the owner's crying, and I'm like, well, why are you crying? I just told your dog Bell's palsy is okay. That's not a big deal. It's nice to meet you. I'm glad you're here today. But I've got a paralyzed dog in the back. I've got to get to it. This has big problems. And she's like, well, you're the first person emotional issues. And it was heartbreaking and heart-wrenching to see him that way. And they were very open to try this, and they sent me a video of him out on a walk with his tail up. I'm thrilled with that, and it's making headway with that. Samson is the dog on the far left, just to talk to you about that, about end of life and veterinary medicine. I'm going to run over now. This little dog was the first dog I ever used ultrasound in. I never met Samson, but he is near and dear in my heart. I usually get a little choked up about this one because it ties into really why I do what I do. I think the biggest gift a veterinarian can give to you all and for our pets who are their stewards is an end-of-life decision when we can no longer help them or give them peace and dignity. We're so far more advanced and blessed than they are in human medicine on that aspect. When enough is enough, we can give them the dignified ending that they deserve. He had bone cancer. The owner wanted 1 week with him. There's probably other family members coming back into town. He was on some aggressive anti-pain medicine. Nothing was touching his bone pain. And an ER doctor that knew I liked cannabinoids and all those things, she called. She said, well, you can use a capsule. I said, capsule's not going to be effective. It's going to take too long. So I have this new product. Will you try it? So I drove it over to her clinic. She gave this to the owner. Owner called the next day. Two doses. They had to put a leash on the dog because he was so rambunctious and happy there. Right? He was going to fracture his leg. So they got another week. Again, not the story, the end of the story that we all want, but a week of being comfortable and happy. You know, and that's really why we do this. We want to do these things. I'm going to go skip all through this. The other thing to talk about real quick with cats, or just in general, when people argue about the human side about placebos, I always say, you don't have a placebo in your pet. There's nothing more genuine. You know, this cat has a urinary stress-induced cystitis or flu, and will pee outside the litter box when things aren't right between its ears. So how are you going to placebo that? Cats either pee in the litter box or it's not. You know, that's the genuine beauty of my patients. They're not trying to hide. They're not trying to get on my best behavior. You're on my good side. You know, they're not being coy. You know, we have dogs that have head tilts and all this. They're just being coy. Price that wrong. They don't normally have a head tilt. But that's sad. So anyway, they do like the lemon better than the berries, what I found. So keep that in mind. The cannabinoid mimetics, I'm playing around with Dream on some of the dogs that have really very tough phobias, thunderstorm phobias, cognitive dysfunction phobia or syndrome, where our traditional sedatives aren't working. This is showing some good promise with that. And I think they're inherent on the human side. A lot of people get in a complement action between ice and ultrasound. So I've got a couple of patients in mind that I think I'm going to start trying that with. So I think that, you know, again, this entourage effect is there for all of us. It affects, again, has the potential for the benefit. So again, thank you for your time. This is